now resumed. And the next item of business is a motion on accelerated passage for the Private Tenancy Coronavirus Modification Bill. Clerk, please read the motion.
That the Private Tenancies Coronavirus Modifications Bill proceed under the accelerated passage procedure.
I call the Minister for Communities. Thank you, Minister. The Business Committee has agreed that there should be no time limit on this debate, and I now call the Minister for Communities to open the debate on the motion.
There and then to the satisfaction of the committee. However, in this case of this proposed legislation and the current public health emergency, there are compelling grounds for departure from the normal procedure and to use accelerated passage. This bill is necessary in order to extend the notice to quit period from 4 to 12 weeks before the date of which it can take effect during this unprecedented public health emergency. As you're aware, mortgage lenders have provided buy-to-let landlords and homeowners with the ability to apply for a 3-month holiday on their repayments. This bill intends to ensure that tenants in the private rented sector are also provided with some protections during this crisis. It will also reduce the movement of people between households, allowing shielding of vulnerable people, self-isolation and social distancing, in line with the Chief Medical Officer's recommendations. I will now explain to the Assembly, as required under Standing Order 42.4, why I am seeking accelerated passage and the consequences of it not being granted. I am asking you to agree accelerated passage to this bill because the crisis has happened quickly and we need to respond. The bill is required as soon as possible in order for it to have any tangible benefit to those living in the private rented sector. This is the fastest growing housing tenure and has around 18% of the total housing stock, with approximately 134,000 properties. Without accelerated passage, there is a risk that the bill will not be enacted before the summer recess. And as I have said previously, this could cause an increase in homelessness, undue stress and worry for tenants. It would totally negate the reason for bringing the bill if it were passed after the worst of the crisis was over. In accordance with Standing Order 42.3, I appeared before the Committee for Communities on the 6th of April to explain the need for accelerated passage for the bill, to outline the consequences of it not being granted. And I want to take this opportunity to thank the Chair and also the members of the committee for their recognition in the need to expedite the bill, and for their support in seeking Assembly approval for accelerated passage. Members will have the opportunity to raise issues of the detail of the bill during the second stage of the debate, and in the interim I seek the support of this House for the use of accelerated passage procedure, and I look forward to hearing members' comments.
I now call the Chairperson of the Committee for Communities, Ms Paula Bradley.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. The committee was briefed by the Minister at its meeting on the 6th of April why this bill was required to proceed under accelerated passage. Members recognise the urgent need to put measures in place that would ensure that tenants in the private rented sector are protected, at least in the short term, from the possibility of eviction. The impact of the crisis on the economy has left many people with a significant reduction in income. For those people in private rented sector, that means an immediate concern about how to pay their rent while they seek to obtain financial support through the benefits system or other means such as the furlough scheme. Accessing support takes time, sometimes longer than we might consider reasonable. In addition, the committee accepted that the possibility of an increased number of evictions was contrary to the public health advice to stay at home and restrict movement. Committee members accepted that it was necessary to have the legislation in place as soon as possible to provide a breathing space for tenants in the private rented sector. I'm sure we will go into more detail in the second stage debate on these and other issues. However, while never the procedure of choice, the committee is supportive of the motion that the bill proceed via accelerated passage.
I call Sinead Ennis.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I too would like to thank the Minister for her fast and decisive action so far in providing the utmost support for housing providers and community and voluntary sector. Amongst other things, this has resulted in a significant reduction in the number of people sleeping rough on our streets. As the Minister has alluded to, homeowners and landlords alike have availed of financial protections, such as domestic household rates haven't been frozen for a period of 3 months, and many banks have issued mortgage holidays whereby mortgage repayments have also been frozen for 3 months. And Minister, I appreciate this is not your remit, and it was alluded to in the earlier debate. You will recall the issue being the main issue of concern for members at the last meeting of the Communities Committee, and that's the continuing millstone of students having to pay for student accommodation that is not being used, while letting agents and landlords enjoy a rates holiday. And quite frankly, this is a disgrace. I would urge the Minister for Economy, if she hasn't already, to work with you and executive colleagues to find a solution for students and their families. I want to thank the Minister on behalf of the hundreds of students and their families for raising the issue of student rents and having highlighted the need to use the hardship fund for students to address this in the same way you have regarding supports for people who are already vulnerable and struggling at this time. I welcome the Minister's decision to increase the notice to quit period for private tenants from 4 weeks to 12 weeks through the use of accelerated passage. This will ensure that private tenants will be protected from becoming homeless within the most critical period of this health emergency. Government guidance states that no one should be moving home during this period, as it may assist the spread of the virus and put undue pressure on our public services. In normal circumstances, we would, of course, be scrutinising the Private Tenancies Bill through the Departmental Committee. However, we all recognise that these are extraordinary times, and this puts an onus on political leaders to act, and to act fast, and to act urgent, and it is for that reason that I support the motion.
I call Mark Durgan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I thank the Minister for coming back here today. I'll save my commentary on the intention behind the bill for the debate on the bill itself, but just in terms of the use of accelerated passage, I'd echo the Chair's sentiments that it is far from ideal. But I think it's fair to say that the circumstances that we find ourselves in are even further from ideal, and failure to get this legislation through in an expedient fashion could be potentially disastrous. So therefore, Minister, you have the support of SDLP.
I call Kelly Armstrong.
Thank you very much, Deputy Speaker. I'm rising on behalf of the Alliance Party to say that while we will be absolutely supporting this bill, it's just to say, as others have said, that accelerated passage is not something that we would have wished to have happened. There are certain things missing from this bill. For instance, if there had been more time and more scrutiny, we might have been able to do something with the retrospective aspect of this bill, because as we know, people who have been notified of evictions are outside of this bill. But just to say that accelerated passage is not the way that we would prefer to go on this, but time is of the essence. And I thank the Minister for her work in bringing this forward quickly. Here's hoping it gets passed later and we have it in place before the end of April.
I call Andy Allen.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. To echo the comments of my committee colleagues, we, the Ulster Unionist Party, would not routinely and lightly support accelerated passage, but given the exceptional nature and circumstances that we find ourselves in, and the fact that this bill will not take effect until it receives royal assent, there is a necessity to deploy this bill by accelerated passage, so we will reluctantly support that. We would have liked to have had more time in the committee to scrutinise the bill, and indeed, as my committee colleague has outlined, other measures could have been perhaps implemented within the bill to safeguard others, but we will support the motion. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Before we proceed to the question, I'd remind members that this motion requires cross-community support. The question is that the Private Tenancies Coronavirus Modifications Bill proceed under the accelerated passage procedure. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. As I am hearing ayes from all sides of the House and no noes, I am satisfied that cross-community support has been demonstrated. The legislation is agreed at this stage. Agreed. The next item of business is the second stage of the Private Tenancy Coronavirus Modifications Bill, and I call the Minister for Communities to move the motion.
I beg to move.
The second stage of the bill has been moved, and in accordance with convention, the Business Committee has not allocated any time limit on this debate. I now call on the Minister to open the debate on the bill.
Thanks very much. And again, thank you to the Chamber. And I suppose, given the urgency of this unprecedented public health emergency, this Private Tenancies Coronavirus Modifications Bill responds to the present outbreak of the coronavirus here. The public health advice is clear: stay at home, protect our key workers and save lives. And responding to this public health advice requires people to have a secure home to reduce the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic on both themselves, their families and others. This is a fundamental necessity to allow government to properly manage the emergency situation. Social distancing, shielding of vulnerable people, self-isolation and quarantine are key ways of stopping the spread of infectious diseases. Yet vulnerable people who have been told by their GP to stay at home for the next 3 months to protect themselves could get a letter through their door this morning, and indeed some of them have, telling them to leave in 4 weeks' time. This is just unacceptable. The difficulties that would cause them are unacceptable, and the stress that it would cause them is also unacceptable, and the rest of their lives is completely unacceptable. I consider the bill necessary to prevent the spread of coronavirus and to provide private tenants and renters with additional support during the COVID-19 period. The private rented sector, as was stated earlier, has around 18% of the total housing stock, with approximately 134,000 properties. Private renters continue to be a group facing significant concerns and anxiety during this period, and in particular due to the loss of employment. There has been support Dubai to let landlords to avail of a 3 month mortgage holiday, and I have announced that private renters can get assistance to pay for their rent through universal credit and discretionary housing payments. There are also various economic support schemes, such as the furlough scheme. These will take time to make payments, and tenants need to know that they cannot be evicted while waiting on these payments to be made. In these extraordinary times, where a number of people will temporarily struggle to pay their rent through no fault of their own, they need certainty in the meantime that their homes are safe and that their landlords can't move to evict them. This legislation will mean no renter in the private accommodation will be forced out of their home during this difficult time. This emergency legislation is urgent priority so that landlords will not be able to start proceedings to evict tenants for a 12-week period. And as a result, no renter needs to be concerned about the threat of immediate eviction. In terms of key features of the bill, it may be helpful for members if I just spend a few minutes outlining the key provisions. The bill has six substantive clauses. It temporarily modifies Article 14 of the Private Tenancies NI Order 2006, which prescribes the length of notice to quit period by reference to the duration of the tenancy. It applies a 12-week notice to quit period for all tenancies during the emergency period. The effect of this is that tenancies of less than 5 years, the notice to quit period has been increased by 8 to 12 weeks. For tenancies between 5 and 10 years, the notice of quit period has been increased by 4 to 12 weeks. And for tenancies of more than 10 years, the notice of quit period remains the same. The bill clarifies that the extension of the notice to quit period will only apply to landlords. Due to the current uncertainty surrounding how long the coronavirus pandemic might last, the Department wishes to protect tenants from eviction during this emergency period, ending with the 30th of September 2020, which is considered a reasonable period of time. The bill gives the Department discretion to specify a shorter or longer period for the end of the emergency period by regulations, subject to negative resolution for up to 2 years. This legislation will mean no renter in the private accommodation will be forced out of their home during this difficult time. This legislation will help reduce unnecessary pressures on the health care, social care and local authority systems that is caused by homelessness, and will ensure that tenants are protected, particularly at these times when their income streams may be vulnerable, and they will be worried about the health and well-being of themselves and their loved ones.
I now call on the Chairperson of the Committee for Communities, Paula Bradley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I rise to make a few comments as Chair of the Committee for Communities. Prior to the current crisis, one of the most important issues our society faced was how to solve the homelessness problem. One element of an effective response to the problem of homelessness is prevention. The impact of the current COVID-19 crisis is wide-ranging, including the potential to put many more people at risk of homelessness, particularly those in the private rented sector who may have lost their jobs. The Minister has introduced this bill to ensure that this risk is minimised. It is also important for members to note that 18% of the population live in the private rented sector in 134,000 properties, so many thousands of individuals and families could potentially be at risk of eviction if support isn't forthcoming. Of course, it is also the case that everyone has been told to stay at home in order to restrict movement and therefore the spread of the virus. This bill will ensure that people in the private rented sector can stay in their homes for longer. It will allow people to self-isolate where necessary, thereby adhering to public health advice. It is worth clarifying that existing legislation in Northern Ireland does not contain grounds for eviction, but rather requires landlords to give tenants notice to quit periods. That provides context to the approach taken by the Minister. Extending the period of notice to quit from 4 to 12 weeks is therefore a proportionate response to the crisis and is comparable with the 3-month mortgage holiday which buy-to-let landlords and homeowners can avail of. However, introducing the concept of proportionality also raises the question. How do we determine when these provisions are no longer proportionate? For example, if the 3-month mortgage holiday isn't extended, would it be proportionate to extend the notice to quit period? This is of particular relevance for those landlords whose rental income is their income. In addition, the committee recognises there are a range of options in place to support income levels. These include the furlough scheme, where people will receive 80% of their salaries, the self-employed scheme, access to universal credit, the discretionary housing scheme, where people who apply and receive universal credit will have their rent paid for 13 weeks, as well as the recently enhanced discretionary support scheme. It is therefore important, as the recent guidance for private rented landlords and tenants issued this week highlights, that tenants engage with their landlord and come to an agreement regarding the payment of rent. Where tenants are able to pay their rent or partially pay their rent, they should. The legislation is to protect those people in actual need. It is not to provide an excuse to private tenants to stop paying their rent altogether. So the principles underpinning the bill, that of preventing evictions and ensuring people adhere to public health advice, are welcomed by the committee. The bill will provide a breathing space specifically for tenants while they work through the process that will allow them to access financial support. But it will also give space to all those involved in the private rented sector to get a sense of how big an issue this is and to put in place measures over the coming months to address it. On this point, it is important to bear in mind that at the end of the crisis, some tenants may be in significant rent arrears. This raises the possibility, while the legislation postpones evictions over the immediate term, there is still the potential for an increased number of evictions to take place within the next year as the crisis subsides. The committee was advised that the department is continuing discussions with the court service on this issue so that there isn't a default to landlords seeking court orders to evict tenants and thus increase the number of homeless in Northern Ireland. The committee therefore recognises the need for this bill and the need to progress it through the House as quickly as possible. That is why we agreed to accelerated passage. This is important as there is no retrospective element to the bill. Its provisions will only come into operation the day after the Act receives royal assent. Mr. Deputy Speaker, the committee expects the department to continue to monitor the impact of COVID-19 on both tenants and landlords in the private rented sector and to respond with policy and legislation on the basis of evidence and discussions with relevant parties as this crisis progresses. The committee, as ever, stands ready to assist and advise the Minister. Thank you.
I call Sinead Innes.
Gurmoy, get last hand cord yet.
Social tenants residing in housing executive or housing association tenancies have been given assurances of no eviction due to COVID-19. Therefore, it is only right that tenants within the private rented sector are not the only section of society that's excluded from protections of shelter. To exclude them, as the Chair mentioned, is to exclude the 134,000 households and families. And I ask members to consider how many within those households have family members who are at high risk of shielding, and how many within those families have now lost their jobs or earnings, possibly forcing them into rent arrears through no fault of their own. An extension of the notice to quit period will make a real difference to those families under stress and worried about losing their home. This Assembly must ensure protections for all citizens during this crisis, including those within the private rented sector. Every minister should be using the power afforded to them at this time to mitigate against the hardships people are facing as a result of this global pandemic. Every single minister should be thinking about how they can use their department to make life easier for citizens and to give people a break at this time. Some are doing that and leading by example. Others are hiding behind the need for legislative amendments and an unwillingness to stretch themselves and meet this crisis head on. This minister, the Minister for Communities, has shown that it can be done. In order for this bill to have any use to those that it is intended to help, then it needs to pass, and it needs to pass quickly. And it is in that context that I ask members to support the bill in front of them today. Gormugit.
I call Mark Durkin.
Mr Deputy Speaker, I rise also in support of the bill. Members in this House will be all too aware, some more than others, of the scourge of homelessness and the devastating impact that has on families and individuals financially, emotionally and psychologically. The threat of homelessness, therefore, at any time is hugely unpalatable, but the threat of homelessness at this time is completely unacceptable. I'd also like to take this opportunity to commend the great work of the Department of the Northern Ireland Housing Executive and most of all the homelessness sector, who have been most hands-on in their approach to tackling this crisis, and we've seen tremendous results of that, so they deserve all our praise. Clearly, the intention of this emergency legislation and its accelerated passage through the Assembly is to mitigate against this threat, to give tenants in private rented accommodation one less thing to worry about at a time when people have so much to be worried about. This legislation isn't perfect, and that's not merely a political view, it's a view shared by some of the most empathetic experts in the field of housing. They've looked at, I suppose, measures in other jurisdictions in the Republic of Ireland, for example, where the issuing of the notice to quit has been banned altogether. I think there's a similar approach in Scotland. So I would like to hear from the Minister, I have already heard, but maybe for the benefit of the House, some clarification as to how or why that can't be done here. There's also a question, and Kelly Armstrong touched on it in the previous debate, in terms of a retrospectivity element of this legislation. There is a fear that some landlords may actually, I know some already will have, but some even now may try to issue notices to quit in advance of this legislation or receiving royal assent. At the other end, it's vital that this legislation has the flexibility to extend beyond the specified date in the bill, should we need to. We must be able to go again in the event of another deadly wave of this virus in the future. Communication of what this bill does, what it means for people, tenants and landlords, needs to be clear and concise. I appreciate the guidance that was issued by the Department last week, but without willing or wishing to sound overly critical, and I'm certainly not criticising the Minister, I think it's fair to say it was pretty clunky. Some will see this bill, or rather what isn't in this bill, as an opportunity to make amendments. Amendments that, if successful, will catch some of those that have fallen through the various safety nets that the Executive have thus far put in place. Students, for example, and I know that has been, they have been referred to Many students are tied into tenancy agreements they are no longer availing of. Most of those who had part-time jobs have lost them due to the ongoing crisis, and many will actually have moved back to their parents' homes themselves, experiencing hardship, and the returning students will have put an additional financial burden on those households as well. I do appreciate that the Department for Economy has responsibility for universities, and Minister Hargey has told us at committee of her collaboration or efforts to work with Minister Dodds's department on the development of the existing Student Hardship Fund. But we need to hear more about that, and those affected need to see the fruit of that labour and collaboration, and they need to see it soon. And if there is none, we must look to the Department for Communities for either a new mechanism of support or to allow students to access existing support from which they are currently excluded. I do recognise that the discretionary support that we spoke of earlier is open to students, but despite efforts to get it out there, awareness remains low, and I'm not sure that people are being signposted towards it before having all their doors closed on them, or as they're having all their doors closed on them. So while the temptation certainly exists for members, or will exist for members and parties, to try to use this bill as a catch-all, or at least catch more, soundings suggest that any attempt to do so could well delay the legislation going through and ultimately defeat its purpose to help people keep a roof over their heads at this extremely stressful time. It would be most useful, therefore, if the Minister could give insight into what other work is being done and assurances that it will be done, so that members do not feel the compulsion to amend, and in doing so, inadvertently delay or even jeopardise this extremely important legislation. While the focus of today's debate is clearly the need to protect tenants, we must also consider landlords, and the Chair of the Committee touched on this. I'd also raised to that committee. The vast majority of our landlords are small or single property landlords. They aren't all big, bad Ebenezer Scrooges. The vast majority of landlords are responsible and reasonable, and this whole situation is one that has caused them headaches and considerable heartache as well. Yes, they do have hearts. Many can and will avail of the mortgage holiday, but that's an option that's not open to or available to all for whom this rental income is their only source of income. Landlords need to know what support they can avail of, and I do know that work is being done with Lanny, and we'd like to hear maybe a wee bit more about that. It's been said before in this House, we can't allow the perfect to be the enemy of the good. This legislation is not perfect, but this legislation is good, and this legislation will do good. So we support the bill.
I call Andy Allen.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, and at the outset, can I declare an interest as a private sector landlord myself? Indeed, my colleague, committee colleague across the way, has raised a number of important matters that I indeed too was going to raise. I'll not rehearse them. I welcome the intention of this bill, and indeed the Minister coming before the committee, as she outlined back on the 6th of April, to engage with us. And I do thank the Minister for her extensive engagement with the committee, and indeed us as Assembly members throughout the course of this pandemic. She has kept us updated, and she's worked constructively with committee members to ensure that we safeguard and protect the most vulnerable within our society. This bill, the intention behind it is to, as has been outlined by previous members and the Minister, to increase the notice to quit period from 4 to 12 weeks for those in that applicable category. At this time, this quite worrying time for us all, right across society, right across the world, individuals should not be worrying as to whether they have a roof over their head, and it's imperative. In fact, it's the right thing to do. It's the right thing for us to do to ensure that we take every proportionate step to make sure that tenants have a roof over their head and they don't have this additional stressor existing over them. As the Minister has alluded to also, there are various support packages which have been announced by various ministers and indeed the UK Government to support, which will potentially support landlords. And indeed, we would hope that that will be commuted in most cases to tenants. But unfortunately, with everything in society, there will always be those bad apples and there will always be those who will be affected by that. It is important to note that the vast majority of the private sector landlords, indeed 18%, 134,000 households has been outlined. The landlords within those are very good. They're very responsible landlords, and in most cases, they do carry out their duties as they should. But there are those who don't, and this bill is required to safeguard those who may be at risk of eviction during this period in time. It's proportionate, it's reasonable, and indeed, I look forward to continuing to engage with the Minister should there be a necessity, I hope there's not, to extend this bill forward. So thank you, Minister, for your engagement, and we support the bill.
I call Kelly Armstrong.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and thank you very much, Minister. As I said in the previous debate, Alliance certainly does support this bill going forward. Yes, it hasn't gone forward in the way that we would have liked. We would like more time for consultation, and that's one of the things I would like to raise here today, and others have mentioned it. We have good and bad landlords in Northern Ireland. We also have good and bad tenants in Northern Ireland. The landlords, through this bill, will be required to ask for at least 12 weeks before they can evict someone from the home. So the notice to quit period has become longer. However, this bill is not going to become an act for another couple of weeks. It'll be 68 weeks from start to finish of this. I think there was a little bit of time for consultation, and I would love to hear if there has been any feedback from the Landlord Association from Northern Ireland on this. I've noted in the bill that you do actually include it's down as 10B, that there will not be an extension to the period for those people who engage in serious antisocial behaviour after this Act comes into effect. And I think we do need that protection, not just for the landlord, so that they can evict bad tenants, but also for the other tenants that are living with these people near them who are causing such difficulties. I'm sure many of us in this House have had reports from citizens, from residents, who have been in contact during the lockdown period to report the house parties and different things that have happened when people have assumed that this is a holiday period as opposed to a killer pandemic. So I take cognizance of the fact that we need to hear from the Landlords Association. I'd also love to see this actually not just being for this pandemic period, but actually longer. And in that, I would love to have seen in this not just the 12-week period, but for instance, other criteria to be considered by landlords before they would choose to evict someone. For instance, how many weeks are outstanding for that person? How much do they owe? Has any partial payment been made? Has there been any negotiation, formal negotiation between the landlord and the tenant before they actually get to this stage? There are other things that we could have brought in, but I appreciate we are where we are at this stage. There are some tenants, like the students that we've talked about, that are on fixed-term contracts. And it's not so much that landlords are asking them to leave their property, they're demanding payment. And I think this is one of the things that the legislation does not currently cover. It's the pressure being put on some landlords by bad tenants and the pressure being put on some tenants by bad landlords. And that lack of relationship really is causing so many problems. As others have said, we have very, very good landlords in Northern Ireland. 84% of landlords only have one or two properties, so they may well be availing of other business supports. For instance, the rates relief has been mentioned, the mortgage break. They may even access the small business loans. You wouldn't know what they're all getting. But for a landlord then to attack, to bully, to put pressure on a tenant, to pay up money that they don't have because they're out of a job, they've been furloughed, they haven't got their payments yet, is very sad to hear. I know that the 12-week period was chosen because originally that's the shielding period. I'm expecting, I'm hoping that I'm completely wrong, but if the shielding period has to be extended, and I'm really hoping that it doesn't have to be extended, but if it does, we'll have to see another amendment to this. And I know that the availability to do that is in here for you. I'm hoping that we do have a period where, come the 30th of September, this is no longer needed, but at least it's in place there for you. I would just like to say there are many landlords that are under pressure. Those landlords cannot afford to pay their own bills, as has been highlighted by my colleague Mark Durkan, MLA. And I think we have to remember them too. In order to keep them and help them to be good landlords, it would be good to actually know that they are getting support. So I would ask you to speak to the Minister for the Economy and see if that £10,000 small business support grant can be extended to those landlords who are providing good houses and good homes. And I'd just also like to pay tribute to the fact that our homelessness figures in Northern Ireland have completely collapsed. With a will, there is a way, and our homelessness situation is being resolved. So what I would ask is that for you, Minister, and your department to do all that you can to continue that as a good news story, to make sure that people no longer have to sleep rough or have or live without a home in our country. Thank you.
I call Jonathan Buckley.
Thank you, Speaker, and I will be brief as the committee has mostly outlined many of my points. I understand the context of this bill in relation to the provisions that have already been put in place for some landlords in relation to the mortgage holiday, 3-month mortgage holiday, and also for the provisions in place, as has been outlined by Mrs. Ennis, in relation to those in housing executive properties. I also understand that given the fact that the courts are not proceeding or processing evictions or repossessions, I think it necessarily makes sense that this supporting legislation is in place. But I want to just briefly go to a point in which Ms. Armstrong quite rightly points out, and it's something that my remarks will just quickly point to in closing, and that is landlords. Because as Ms. Armstrong has pointed out, it is very easy when legislation such as this comes before the House to demonise landlords. I understand that, and I understand that there has been some in times past that have acted in a totally unbefitting manner to both vulnerable tenants and others. But we do have to recognise the fact that there are many landlords that are helping people. They've already, before anything came in place, entered into agreements with their tenants to enable payments in these difficult circumstances. And we also have to note the fact that, as has been said, that for many private landlords, this is their only source of income. And while they have had access to a 3-month mortgage holiday, that does not mean that the financial pressure goes away. It's put on hold. So I do believe that one of my primary concerns in relation to this legislation is the potential abuse that could come, not only from, as has been mentioned, some of those, it's there to prevent those overzealous landlords from acting in an unbefitting way, but it places more liberties at the hands of some residents that potentially could abuse the system. Because there is no, the department actually outlined that if there is landlords are facing problems with tenants in terms of antisocial behaviour, that the only form of redress that they have is currently to approach the PSNI. That, in all necessity, may not result in any action, but it would put a lot of pressure on communities that potentially look across to neighbouring properties, seeing those that aren't abiding by social distancing practices, neighbourhood parties, etc., and the landlord has no actual ability to deal with that. The Minister, I welcomed the conversation at the committee in relation to this bill. I thought that was most helpful. We did raise a lot of concern in relation to how we would communicate this. Since then, I recognise that there has been a level of communication both with the Landlords Association and indeed a wider remit of tenants and with the committee. That's important because in anything, communication is essential in this. Landlords must be provided with the relative information that they know that they're providing and operating within the law. One point to bear in mind as well, that there's the department's approach seems to allow for a reasonable period of time for a landlord and a tenant to come to some sort of reasonable agreement in relation to payments. But as you and I know, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that in albeit a lot of these delicate circumstances of where the tenant-landlord relationship has wholly broke down, the ability to find reasonable agreement may be reasonable to one party and wholly unreasonable to the other, and that can work both ways. So I would appreciate maybe if the Minister could go into a bit more detail as to how we can ensure that there has been reasonable agreement. The point was mentioned about the potential need for extension to this measure depending on how this public health emergency progresses. I would have some concern in relation to that as well, because maybe the three-month mortgage holiday will extend potentially to cover that period, and then this legislation will then mirror that in subsequent action. Yes, of course.
I appreciate the member giving way, and he's right, as are other members, in highlighting a range of potential scenarios. And I think it would be important, and I'm sure the Minister can address this, that there is built into this legislation an ability to bring forward regulations if there are circumstances that subsequently transpire that won't require further primary legislation, that action can be taken. The spirit behind this legislation is good. It is commendable. It is to address those people that have fallen between the cracks, and we know people that are in this type of situation, and this bill will help them. But it is important that where there is abuse of the system, whether it be by tenants or indeed by landlords, that that can subsequently be addressed by the department, and the minister has the necessary legislative authority to do that.
I give away. Absolutely, would agree entirely with his comments. It's important that that flexibility is there, that we can mirror and match the situation that unfolds. My point was being that if this public health emergency continues and that three-month mortgage holiday is potentially continued, well, again, I reiterate the point that it is literally a pause in payment. The money still has to come when this period ends. So I think there is a plethora of consequences, no matter what way you look at this here, but I do welcome the point in which the member has outlined that having that flexibility and that ability from the minister to intervene and change as is needed is essential in going forward in dealing with this fast changing environment in which we find ourselves. Thank you, Principal Deputy, or Deputy Speaker.
I call John O'Dowd.
And I rise to support the bill and the measures which the Minister has outlined, because they are necessary. And it is yet another piece of legislation or a policy or an initiative from the Minister during this period to help protect those workers and families and people who have found themselves in significant financial difficulties as a result of the COVID-19 crisis. At the outset of this crisis, I said that the main priority was to save lives, but we also needed to keep roofs and food on people's tables, and roofs over people's heads. And certainly this is one of those pieces of legislation that will keep a roof over an out-of-work worker's head and their families and those who find themselves in difficulties. It has been said time and time again that the social housing sector, in terms of the Housing Executive and the housing associations, already have measures put in place, and it's only right and proper that the private renting sector is also covered by legislation to protect tenants and also landlords as well. But it does flag up an issue. And for me, it flags up an issue that social housing should not be a commodity that is traded on the open market. What we need to do is go back to a situation where social housing is provided by the Housing Executive and our housing associations. And I think that's there's lots of lessons to be learnt from the COVID-19 crisis, certainly how to deal with the pandemic in health terms, but also how we as a society govern and manage and look after some of our most vulnerable in society, and some of our most low-paid workers, who now we have found out are our frontline and essential workers. So for future, I think what this highlights to me is that social housing should be provided by social housing providers other than the private rented sector. When I look at communities, I can use my own constituency as an example, where we had communities that have social cohesion has broken down over a number of years. There's a number of factors for that. But one of the factors I often trace back to is that many of the properties in what once would have been Housing Executive housing estates have now become private rented. And while there is many good private landlords, I'm not disputing that, there's many, many good private landlords, but they aren't as good as the Housing Executive. They don't have the same social skills and social conscience, in many cases, as the Housing Executive, the housing associations have. So when a society or a community starts to break down, one of the keys in the past would have been that you'd have brought in the housing authority into the area, you would have worked with them, you would have helped initiatives and all, but you can't do that with 5 or 6 or 10 or 20 private landlords. So there's a lesson for us going forward. Another lesson to be learned from this terrible time we're going through. Social housing should be provided by a statutory body, housing executive, possibly housing associations. But certainly, I would also like to, in terms of...
I thank the member for giving way, and while he points it out that it may be a lesson to be learnt, we can't get away from the simple fact that it's simple demand and supply. Without the supply of housing from that private rented sector, a lot of our community who are in need, in particular social housing need, could end up homeless, as was been outlined earlier by some of the members. So we can't get away from the reality that the demand and supply is simply not there within terms of the housing executive, etc., or the housing associations. The private rented sector plays a crucial role in supplying housing to those that are in need.
I agree with the member, but we have to create a new reality. That's the argument I'm making, and I suppose that's the debate that needs to start. We need to create a new reality. There was policy decisions made in the 80s and late 90s which brought us to where we are now in terms of social housing. I think those policy decisions need reversed, and we need to invest, and the executive needs to invest significantly in a social housing building programme, which allows then for the need to be met by a different sector. But the point I wanted to go on to was the retrospective nature of this, or some seeking retrospective legislation, which in itself I think is very, very difficult to do. To introduce retrospective legislation and even enforce retrospective legislation can be very, very difficult to do. But tenants who are facing eviction at this moment in time should be aware of their rights. A landlord simply cannot put you on the street. A landlord cannot go into your house and change the locks. A landlord cannot hand you a letter and say you have to leave. Tenants should know their rights. And I'm sure each and every one of us run constituency services. There's housing rights organisations out there, and there's many people who can give tenants who find themselves in that position now to come forward and get advice from. There is a legal process you have to go through and has to be followed before any landlord can put any tenant out on the street. And if a tenant has found themselves in financial difficulties at this time, and they accept landlords also face financial difficulties at this time, no tenant should be put out on the street during this period. It is just inexcusable for it to happen. And the landlords should realise they're not getting any new tenants at this stage. No one's moving properties at this stage. So it's best to work with your tenants and find a solution to that. I also finally want to touch on the issue of students. Yes, there is a crisis for students in housing and rent and agreements that have been signed up to. But this is not the minister who has to solve that problem. That problem needs to be solved in the Department of Economy, or it needs to be solved by the executive. And there has to be collective roles and a whole lot of those things. So, as someone else said, we can't overly delay this legislation. We could put many amendments to it. I'm sure all the political parties, I'm sure the minister would like to add different bits and pieces to it. But we have to try and solve as many this problem now and work through other problems as they arise. So I support the passage of the legislation.
I call Gerry Carroll.
Thanks, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I mean, it goes without saying that the COVID-19 crisis has been a very worrying time for lots of people in our society, first and foremost those directly affected by the illness and whose health has suffered because of it. But I think this crisis has exposed various sections of our society and the lack of rights and security that exists for them. It's been brought to light as a result of this health pandemic. And one of those people, one of those groups, are renters. People who are often ignored and disregarded by institutions such as this need to ensure that they have cast iron support and strong rights at this time, as others have mentioned and alluded to. And while there are some welcome measures in this bill, moves that certainly we wouldn't oppose, I think ultimately it doesn't go far enough. The notice to quit period should be extended beyond 4 weeks, but surely this should be the state of play already. Too often we hear of stories of renters rushing around trying to find another place to live without adequate time, as legally their landlord only has to give 4 weeks' notice that the property has to be vacated. People who have been paying rent in their properties for years in many cases are left with little support or leeway when it comes to trying to find a new property. Tenants who have entered a 12-month contract and legally have to live up to that no matter what, while a landlord can break that term with only 4 weeks' notice. How is this fair in any way? And if the Assembly has the power to stop this, why shouldn't we do it permanently? And surely a suspension of this unfair measure should exist in so-called normal times, and not be merely a temporary measure for a pandemic. There's some specific questions that I want to ask the Minister, and I hope she can answer them today or very soon before the debate recommences next week. In relation to the exemptions, I think we need more clarity and concrete detail as to what is required from the landlord, from their end. Under the exemptions to the granting of the 12-week extension, it states if a landlord needs to live in the property, but there appears to be no criteria as to what the landlord needs to present to support this. Will this automatically be allowed on the say-so of the landlord, or will there be a process that they will have to complete? And I appreciate a reply on that. Because surely if no mechanisms are in place to protect tenants, then this system is open to misuse and abuse. If a landlord takes umbrage toward a particular tenant, what exists to protect them from this action being used against them? And I appreciate that the courts are not currently sitting in order to enforce evictions, but they may well soon be, and this piece of legislation could potentially present loopholes if so. We also had to mention what hasn't been done so far, not by the Minister but by the Executive as a whole, in relation to housing and supporting tenants at this time. Students have obviously been mentioned, who are correctly following the medical advice and are practising social distancing by staying at home with their families. Surely people will agree here that it's totally unfair and untenable that these students still have to pay their landlords for the remainder of their tenancy. And the Minister, in a previous debate, said or certainly indicated that she doesn't have the power to suspend rent payments for those in the private sector. I would like to ask the Minister, would she support such measures being taken? We're obviously living in a pandemic, and surely we should welcome people following the guidance, the medical guidance, and cast scorn on those profiting out of this situation. We have a mortgage holiday for landlords. Why is there not a rent holiday for private renters? And it's especially unforgivable when we have students who have lost their job and are hit with a bill of several hundred pounds at the end of every month for a rent. What a kick in the teeth for those people. And surely the Executive should bring in measures swiftly to ensure people aren't out of pocket or up to their eyes in debt, because they are doing the right thing to protect themselves and their family and correctly following the medical advice. Additionally, surely we should have a suspension of rent for all housing executive tenants as well. Housing executive tenants are often among the people most struggling to afford the cost of living, which has obviously been aggravated during the time of the COVID-19 crisis, with job losses, salary reductions, and some families seeing a great increase in the cost of spending to pay for more food, electricity, and gas, and so on.
Right. I just want to tease him out on the point that he's made, because I have every sympathy and I agree with helping those that are in real need facing financial difficulty. But is the member saying that there should be a universal suspension of all payments of housing executive rent, irrespective of the situation that you deal with, as in those that aren't impacted financially as a result of what's happening, they should also get a universal freeze and not have to pay anything?
People who are housing executive tenants are financially impacted by this crisis in one way or another, and I give scenarios where they have been affected. So I think measures need to be put in place to ensure that they are protected and not financially penalised at this time. And just to bring my remarks to a conclusion, Mr. Deputy Speaker, given that this legislation is also not backdated, I think we do need a bit of clarity as to what the position would be, for example, if a tenant was issued a notice to quit before this legislation will likely come into place. And again, I appreciate the courts aren't sitting, so they couldn't be legally evicted. But when the courts resit, would the landlord have a case to say that the tenant ignored a notice to quit and potentially affecting their rental future? I think we need a bit more clarity around this and the other issues raised, and I appreciate the Minister to give clarity on those issues today. Thank you.
I now call on the Minister for Communities, Ms. Deirdre Hargey, to conclude and wind up the debate on the second stage of the bill.
Yeah, thanks very much for that. And obviously there's a lot of questions and points raised there. And again, just thank members for this. Obviously, we're using accelerated passage. It's not your normal timescale. And I find I keep saying this every time I come into this chamber. But it obviously is the circumstances that we're in. And just how I've had to respond to the public health emergency. The concern then around the issue of retrospective, I mean, I looked at this and it's obviously an issue that I would want to move on. The concern is the time scale, because it does have implications in terms of competing human rights. And it's the arguments and the debates, whether it's the Attorney General or others. We know that this would definitely be open to a judicial review. And the concern again is the undue delay that this would cause to a bigger number of people then who would then have those eviction notices looked at. We have seen that when we look at other jurisdictions, other devolved institutions, that they have moved in the same vein in terms of looking at the legislation from the point that it reaches royal assent. And that's the quickest way that we can find of doing this. But of course, we're still going to look at other ways that we can support people. In the interim, conscious that people have already been issued with letters around notices to quit, I mean, I do think it is disgraceful that a landlord would do this in this scenario and in this situation at this time, when clearly the public health message, the political message, the community message is that people need to stay at home and should stay at home in order to save lives. That's why the guidance has been issued, where we're saying that there should be no evictions at this point. So even outside of this legislation being brought forward, that guidance clearly says that. That guidance can then be used in the court proceedings, because it was touched on that you can't just put somebody out. Well, you have to go through a due process, and that has to go through a legal proceeding as well. And obviously the judge then can look at the guidance that has been issued by the department as well when they're deliberating on these issues. Notwithstanding as well, the courts aren't sitting for everyday hearings at the moment, and they won't be sitting over the coming weeks either. So that is some of the issues, and obviously I wanted to move on this legislation. It already obviously is taking a bit of time just because of the different hoops that it has to go through. I do want to obviously thank the Speaker's office and the Assembly for allowing these two stages to be heard on the one day as well. I know it's a first in terms of that, but I think it shows the seriousness in which people look at this issue in the time ahead. I suppose the engagement, we have spoke to Lani, there's been engagements with estate agents and with others, and I think everybody recognises, whilst you may have some landlords that don't agree with it, people do recognise the public health emergency that we're in. That we do have to protect tenants. The fact is that if they were to make somebody homeless out on the street, the impact that that would have, but also that they're not going to get a new tenant into their house in the interim as well. And so therefore I would ask all landlords and letting agents that they need to show, I suppose, compassion on this issue, and that they also need to show that flexibility. And again, within the guidance, we have set out clearly in terms of that you do have to show reasonable in terms of repayments, that you can't be forcing somebody to repay their arrears that they may incur in this period in the next 3 months or 4 months, that it's going to take a more longer period in order to do that. And again, that would have to go to a judge in terms of an eviction proceeding, for a judge to look at what would be reasonable and what wouldn't be reasonable. The question come up around Scotland, I suppose, in terms of having a longer the period of extension. And again, this comes down to a balancing of rights. Obviously, I don't want to get caught up in the conversation around rights. They're important issues, but I want to make sure that we can protect people as quickly as possible. It would cause undue delay, and as I said, if we don't get this through in this time scale now in terms of getting royal assent, we wouldn't be moving on this bill possibly until after the summer, and that's just too late. The evictions are already taking place and they could be happening. So I needed to move on this now. Scotland has adopted the same, they have adopted the same approach. The only issue is they have brought in the first 6 months rather than the 12 weeks. But I have the ability after the 12 weeks to extend this for another 6 month period if that is the need to be done, obviously in consultation with the Attorney General and with others. The 2 points then in terms of the evictions, and I suppose that's same to the Scottish legislation, around a landlord seeking their property in terms of going back to live. They would have to demonstrate that in front of a judge. They would have to show to a judge that they have no other means or recourse or no other property that they can return to. And again, this was why we didn't include this in the first 12 weeks, because we don't want a loophole or this being abused in that period. But we do know as this runs on, that again, there could be those competing human rights that we need more time to consider. But we just don't have the time to do all of that now, because we need to move on the evictions and ensuring that we're stopping them as quickly as we possibly can. The other area, and again, sorry, those two areas, I will be defining those further within the next couple of weeks if we feel that this has to be extended. So it's been based in the legislation. Obviously, the Attorney General has been involved as well. And I know even since then, in looking at issues like Scotland, the issue of domestic violence has been raised as a potential area that would maybe need to be looked at as we're drafting any future extension to this bill. So all of those issues would be refined more clearly, and then they would be brought back in terms of the agreement. In terms of the student issue, I mean, this has come up a lot of times, and it's not within my, I know I'm the minister responsible for housing, but the issue in terms of contracts that has been made is under contract law, so it doesn't come under housing law. I don't have the power or the responsibility around contract law, and I've tried to look at everything that I possibly can within my remit, within my competency, because I do recognise the hardship that many students are facing. It is a common law issue, and therefore it is based within Westminster. But I have engaged with the Department for the Economy and obviously Minister Diane Dodds there. In terms of the issue of students, I've asked for the Student Hardship Fund to be increased. And I know that she's proactively looking at that at the moment, but obviously she would be better placed to respond to that than I would. We're continuing to meet. I know the issue of homelessness has come up, and obviously we have had good figures over the last couple of weeks in terms of the issue of street-based homelessness. That has to be welcomed. I would agree that it shouldn't be a pandemic that kind of resolves these issues, and obviously it's an area that before this pandemic I wanted to seriously look at as well. But there is the issue of, I suppose, the hidden homelessness that is those thousands of families and over 21,000 children involved that are sofa surfing, that are in hostel accommodation. And indeed, this feeds into the other conversation around public housing, how we value public housing, a massive investment programme around public housing as we go forward, and seeing it as an essential public service in terms of meeting that need. I did want and did intend to set out plans as to how we grow our housing stock over this period, and particularly to meet that need in those areas of highest need as well. Again, obviously that's been stunted a bit because we're responding to this pandemic, but I do want to bring forward proposals in the time ahead that will start to readdress and have that conversation around public housing as well. And the other issue, I suppose, that come up, and I know it come up previously, around rents and a rents freeze, and again within the social rented sector. But I would err on the side of caution in that over 70% of the income around rents derived are through housing benefit. If we put on a housing freeze, that freezes that money coming in via the block grant, and therefore we can't pay staff within those housing authorities. We can't maintain the stock. I've already been in here in early February, I think, talking about the sustainability of the housing executive, talking about how we need to invest in public housing and the resources that we need to do it. And if we don't have that income coming in, then we can't reinvest. We can't even maintain the existing stock that we have. And again, that hit the headlines even in February as well. So you can't, it's nice to say that you can do all of these things, but you need to look, oh, are you going to make a situation worse at the other end of this? And there are some of the things that we have to look at. But we have introduced new measures around the housing benefit supplement in terms of benefit support, where we are paying that at 100%. We are obviously looking at the discretionary support. Where I could include students and others, then I have done it within my own remit. But as was touched on, this all doesn't fall within my department. And in fact, it all doesn't fall within this assembly. I suppose it again shows the constraints of devolved administration. And when we don't hold our own fiscal levers That's a huge constraint as well, and it's something that probably needs to be looked at in a conversation in the time ahead.
Members, the question is that the second stage of the Private Tenancies Coronavirus Modifications Bill be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. And that concludes the second stage of the Private Tenancies Coronavirus Modifications Bill. I would advise members that the Minister for Communities has requested that the remaining stages of the bill are scheduled for next week's sitting on the 28th of April. The deadline for amendments is 12 o'clock noon tomorrow, Wednesday, the 22nd of April. The next item of business is a motion to suspend certain standing orders relating to the passage of the Private Tenancies Coronavirus Modifications Bill through the Assembly. Clerk, please read the motion.
That standing orders 31 brackets D, 37, 39 brackets 1 and 42 brackets 5 be suspended in respect of the passage of the Private Tenancies Coronavirus Modifications Bill.
I call on the Minister for Communities to move the motion.
Yeah, I beg to move.
Thank you, Minister. The Business Committee has agreed that there should be no time limit for this debate, and I call on the Minister to open the debate on the motion. Minister.
Yeah, again, thanks very much, and just again, I thank the Assembly in terms of this motion, and obviously I firmly do believe in due process in terms of the legislation that needs to pass through the Chamber and the Committee, but obviously we're not in normal times, as we're finding more and more with this committee and the legislation that needs to come through. But obviously on this occasion with a public health emergency, I do feel, and I'm asking for the suspension of those standing orders, and in seeking your support I'm specifically asking that these standing orders in the motion are suspended, which removes further consideration stage and suspends standing order 42.5, which states that no bill shall pass all its required stages in the Assembly in less than 10 days. I hope the members will support this motion on this occasion, taking into account the very real dangers of evictions in the private rented sector, which could increase homelessness and be in terms of a public health issue.
I call Sinead Innes.
I want to say I appreciate the comments from the members today, and there's a clear recognition of the need to expedite these measures through this Assembly, and the need to act fast and to act now, notwithstanding the issues that members have mentioned in terms of the accelerated passage. But this is the biggest health emergency in a generation, and these standard orders must be suspended to allow the Private Tenancies Bill to pass and to be effective now when it is needed most. If we are to protect families from becoming homeless through no fault of their own, then accelerated passage of this bill is the only viable option, and we need to act now with the utmost urgency. This bill will ensure that no one will lose shelter at the most critical time of self-isolation, and therefore to not support this motion is to put lives in danger. Thank you.
I call Mark Durkin.
Thanks a million, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Sorry, it hadn't been my intention to speak on this motion, but I just echo the remarks of the previous member on this. We have a real need for speed here, so we support the Minister in her endeavours.
I now call the Minister for Communities, Ms. Deirdre Hargey, to conclude and wind up the debate on the motion.
Yeah, just again, thanks very much, everyone. And I suppose I understand that this measure today shouldn't become the norm, and I wouldn't be advocating that at all, but I would ask you to support the motion in front of you.
Again, members, before we proceed to the question, I would remind members that this motion requires cross-community support. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I'm hearing ayes from all sides of the House and no noes. The motion is therefore agreed. The motion is agreed. And I'm satisfied that cross-community support has been demonstrated. Item number 3 in the order paper, the adjournment. The question is that the Assembly do not adjourn. The Assembly is adjourned.